And thank you to everyone for tuning in this evening. It's nice to see so many people coming along, especially when we have the chance to have people from much further afield than is normally the case. Today, I'm going to take a look at life in the 1820s at Barmeath through the letters written by Lady Bellew from Barmeath to her daughter, Fanny, Lady Smythe in England. But before I get into that, I just want to give a very brief background to Barmeath and the Bellew family. Many of you will be familiar with it, but for in case we have a few who aren't, a short introduction. So the Bellews first arrived in Ireland from Yorkshire in the 12th century and established themselves in the Meath and Louth area. Barmeath in County Louth has been the home of one branch of the family since the 17th century. And this is Barmeath Castle today, which is probably familiar to most of you. It's viewed here with Dundalk Bay in the background. It was acquired in the 17th century by John Bellew, a lawyer and landowner who inherited Lisrennie from his father and later purchased Willistown. But following the 1641 rebellion, John, like many others of the Catholic Old English families, was transplanted to Connacht and his property in Louth was confiscated. Following the restoration of Charles II, John's attempts to reclaim his original property in Louth were thwarted, but his efforts as agent and lawyer for his cousin, the Earl of Carlingford, were rewarded when Carlingford conveyed a part of his restoration grant in Louth, including Barmeath, to John Bellew. The formal conveyance from Carlingford was signed in 1671, so it was exactly 350 years ago this year. John died in 1679 and was succeeded by his eldest son, Patrick, who became Sir Patrick Bellew when he was granted a baronetcy by James II. Barmeath today is still the home of his direct descendants. The present Lord Bellew, the barony dates from the 1840s, is the 12th generation of his family to own Barmeath. The building at Barmeath has, of course, evolved. The earliest building was a 10-pound tower house, which still survives within the fabric of an 18th century Georgian house. The present castellated form was a fashionable upgrade carried out in the 1830s. But in the 1820s, the period we're looking at today, Barmeath was still in its Georgian form, which can be seen here in a painting from 1785 by William Ashford. Barmeath is home not just to the Bellew family, but also an extensive family archive collected over centuries. This archive is the major source for my thesis research, which is an examination of the experience of a Catholic landed family during the penal era, which followed the Williamite Wars. The Bellews of Barmeath are a rare instance of a Catholic landed family who remained Catholic throughout the penal era in Ireland. As Catholic landowners, they were the primary targets of the penal or popery laws. Land conferred power and status, and the minority Protestant population who governed 18th century Ireland were determined to protect their position by controlling ownership of land. Catholics were barred from purchasing land or taking long leases, and were subject to the infamous gavel, which required that any land held in fee by a Catholic must be divided equally amongst his sons on his death. This would force the breakup of any remaining large estates held by Catholics, or alternatively force those landowners to conform to the established church. Other provisions of the penal code, particularly those affecting education, military service, and eligibility for government or judicial roles, also had significant impact for these families. My thesis covers the entire penal era from the 1690s through to Catholic emancipation in 1829. The early part focuses largely on the legal complexities of the period. The penal code evolved piecemeal over a period of about 50 years and provided a lucrative opportunity for lawyers of the period as people struggled to interpret the changing laws and finding ways to work around them or alternatively to exploit them for personal gain. All of this is evident in the Bellew papers. But towards the end of the 18th century and into the 19th century, as restrictions were gradually relaxed and removed, the focus turns to the political campaigns to restore Catholics to full civil rights. Today's talk focuses on the final decade of the study, the 1820s, and takes a closer look at one particular set of letters from that period. So, who were the Bellews in the 1820s? The owner of Barmeath in 1820 was the sixth baronet, Sir Edward Bellew. Edward was born about 1758, the eldest of nine sons of the fifth baronet, Sir Patrick Bellew, and his wife, Mary Hoare. There were two daughters in the family as well. As a Catholic, Edward had been sent abroad for his education. He and five of his brothers were educated at the English Benedictine St. Gregory School in Douai in France in the 1770s. After leaving Douai, Edward spent about a year at an academy in Italy, part formal education and part mini grand tour. He eventually returned to Ireland to assist his father with state estate affairs. Edward and his brother William, a lawyer and one of the first Catholics later admitted to the Irish bar, also joined their father as members of the Catholic Committee campaigning for Catholic relief. Another colleague on the Catholic Committee was Richard Strange. The Strange family, like the Bellews, were a Catholic landowning family whose lands in Waterford had been confiscated in the 17th century. When the Derby estate in Louth was put up for sale in 1783, the year after the Catholic Relief Act, which removed the bar on land purchase by Catholics, Strange wrote to Sir Patrick seeking his advice about the land for sale. Strange eventually purchased about 900 acres close to Barmeath, the townlands of Toher, Wyandstown, Boycetown, and Mitchelstown. Strange's new interest in Louth also led to the marriage of his daughter, Mary Ann, and Edward Bellew. Mary Ann was the only child and heiress of Richard Strange and his wife, Bridget Lacey. And this is Mary Ann in a portrait here, which is at Barmeath, and obviously showing her in her younger days, not the 1820s. Edward and Mary Ann were married in September 1786. Mary Ann's dowry was £10,000. She would also inherit all of her father's property and had longer term expectations from a cousin of her father. Edward and Mary Ann's only daughter, Frances, or Fanny as she was known, was born about 1790. Sir Patrick Bellew died in 1795, and Edward and Mary Ann, now Sir Edward and Lady Bellew, took up residence at Barmeath. Their first son, Patrick, was born in 1798 in London, and a second son, Richard, was born in 1803, also in London. In 1808, the 10-year-old Patrick was sent to school at his father's alma mater, St. Gregory's. The monks had been forced to leave France after the French Revolution, and the school, which eventually found a permanent home at Downside, was in 1808 at a temporary home in England at Acton Burnell in Shropshire. Acton Burnell was the seat of Sir Edward Smythe, another former pupil and classmate of Sir Edward Bellew's. Their renewed friendship resulted in the marriage the following year, 1809, of Sir Edward Bellew's daughter, Fanny, and Sir Edward Smythe's only son, also Edward. This marriage uniting two old Catholic families was considered a great success by all their families, by all their friends in England and Ireland. One slight gripe from John Taff of Smarmore Castle, who was a little unhappy. He had evidently hoped for a match with Fanny for one of his sons. One actual problem did result. Fanny's new home at Acton Burnell, which was close to Shrewsbury on the main London Holyhead Road, became a popular stopping point for Fanny's Irish relatives and friends, who invariably also wanted to see Fanny's young brother in the school. This proved far too disruptive for young Patrick's education, and he was therefore moved from the school at Acton Burnell to the Catholic St. Mary's College at Ascot. So skipping forward from that marriage to 1820, Patrick was by now 22, home in Ireland, learning about farming and estate management and enjoying an active social life. Richard, whose early education was at the Maynooth Lay College and St. Thomas's College in Dublin, was now 17, about to complete 2 years at the Jesuit Stonyhurst College in Lancashire. He returned to Ireland in 1820 and entered Trinity College the following year. Mary Ann's father, Richard Strange, had died in 1816. His 900 acres in Louth had passed to Mary Ann and were now part of the Barmeath estate, which in total now included almost 5,000 acres. And at Acton Burnell, Fanny and Edward Smythe by now had six children and still counting. So this slide shows Acton Burnell as it would have appeared in 1820. An earlier lodge had been upgraded by Fanny and Edward, and the extension you see to the side of this was added on for the St. Gregory School. The elder Edward Smith died in 1811. His son inherited the baronetcy and Fanny became Lady Smythe. The two continued to live primarily at Acton Burnell. Fanny received many letters at Acton Burnell from family and friends, and a large collection, somewhere between 700 and 800, are now at Barmeath. How they came to be at Barmeath is a mystery, as other papers of the Smythe family are in the various county archives in England where the family had property. But they are a very valuable part of the Barmeath collection. Family archives normally hold only incoming letters written to the family. So this very unusual instance of an archive holding a large set of outgoing letters, which provide first-hand detail about the life of the family, is particularly important. They cover 50 years, from 1811 to 1860, when Fanny died. They provide a detailed insight into the lives of the Bellews, their extended family and friends in Louth, Dublin, and elsewhere. Almost 300 of them are from Fanny's mother, Mary Ann, written between 1811 and Mary Ann's death in 1837. These letters from mother to daughter cover almost all aspects of their lives. They are informative about both domestic and local affairs and include much commentary on the political and social activities of the various members of the family. They cover education, religious practice, medical concerns, and plenty of gossip. Mary Ann's opinions are frequently entertaining, and she wasn't shy about expressing them in writing or evidently in person. From a practical point of view, her handwriting is relatively legible for the period anyway. The biggest problem with them is trying to figure out dates. She rarely dated her letters with any detail, so it has to be figured out from context. So what can we learn from these letters? And we're going to look at a few examples. We start with domestic affairs, which were naturally always a concern. Lady Bellew often wrote about such issues. Household staff appear to have been an ongoing challenge. Senior staff, housekeepers, cooks, butlers, and ladies' maids were invariably hired in Dublin. Various problems could arise, especially when families were separated. In 1821, she wrote, "I have just had the disagreeable work of hiring a maid who is also to be housekeeper. She seems promising, but anxious about her baby and now remains in Dublin until she weans it. And I suppose in due time we'll have another, but it is useless looking too much forward." And in the same letter, "Our butler is following his wife. He is a correct religious man and I suppose does not like to fall out with her." He's generous. "I feel quite happy since she is gone, for she answered the most disagreeable idea one forms of a complete lady's waiting woman." 2 years later, she wrote from Dublin, where she was again looking for a new butler. "As Deegan, who has a very nice wife, and I am sure is past the age of folly, fell desperately in love with the little fat housemaid. I sent her away," which is unfortunate for the housemaid, "and thought all over, for he answered us very well, but it had not the effect, and I parted with him." Evidently, the housemaid wasn't sent far enough away. And it seems Deegan's wife had later appeared at Barmeath in search of him. The pair returned to Dublin, where the poor wife had promised to give up her friends and convert to Catholicism in the hopes of satisfying her errant husband. Lady Bellew thought the wife was being quite too good, which is probably true, but it's unlikely the unfortunate woman had much choice from a financial point of view. The staff were also evidently well trained. In January 1827, she described the slow step and solemn voice of the servant, presumably the butler, who came to inform them after dinner that the house was on fire. Even in an emergency, the butler was careful to maintain his formal demeanor. They were able to put the fire out in time, although not without some damage. Lady Bellew also took enormous interest in her daughter's children and routinely sent her daughter much advice on breastfeeding, weaning, nursery maids and governesses, some of whom were sent from Ireland to Acton Burnell. She does not appear to have had much interest in food, as she didn't often mention it. She sometimes commented on the grapes and pineapples which were grown at Barmeath. She also often asked Fanny to send venison to Dublin or Barmeath from the deer park at Acton Burnell. It seems shipping fresh meat from England to Ireland was quite efficient at the time. They didn't have to worry about the Irish sea border back then. One food-related topic was, however, very important to Lady Bellew, that of fasting during Lent. She was extremely observant of the practice and always curious about how others observed it. She was pleasantly surprised to find English Catholics in London to be quite good. But the French, at least in Paris, were hopeless. Dispensations were granted on request by the clergy to anyone who asked, and the practice was largely ignored. And she was always greatly disappointed when friends and family, her son Richard in particular, failed to properly fast or abstain. Where are we? So Mary Ann also regularly described the family's social life in Ireland for Fanny, both at home in Louth and in Dublin, where they had a townhouse in Eccles Street. Their close friends were predominantly Catholic, but it's clear that in Louth, at least, they participated fully in the social life of all the local gentry. even when those social interactions were seemingly at odds with what might have been expected given political or religious differences. In social situations, class and status clearly trumped other considerations. Families whose names regularly appear in reports of dinners, dances, and picnics include the Fortescues, Bellinghams, and McClintocks from the local Protestant gentry, and the Tafts, Burns, and Fitzgeralds from the Catholics. Their immediate neighbours, at least when considering the big houses in the 1820s, were the McClintocks of Drumcar House and the Count and Countess de Salis at Rokeby Hall. Both families were Protestant. The de Salises were new neighbours. The Count had recently purchased the town of Dunlear from the Coddingtons, and he leased Rokeby Hall from the Robinson family. The Countess had local connections. She was a niece of John Foster of Cullen, the former Speaker. Lady Elizabeth McClintock at Drumcar was equally well connected. She was a daughter of the first Earl of Clancarty and sister to the second Earl. And her husband, John McClintock, was another Foster connection. His mother was a cousin to the Speaker. The three families regularly socialized, both formally and informally. The Countess in particular became a close friend of the Bellews. John Foster, who was raised to the peerage as Lord Oriel in 1821, was by now, officially at least, retired from politics and was also a relatively close neighbour in Cullen. Foster had long been one of the most forceful defenders of the Protestant ascendancy and was ever opposed to concessions to Catholics. But despite that, there was an apparently amiable relationship, at least when politics were not under discussion, between the Fosters and the Bellews, and visits between the two households were not unusual. The other major political family in Louth, the Dundalk area-based Jocelyns, headed by the Earl of Roden, were equally on good social terms with the Bellews. In this case, the friendship between the families was of several generations standing, and the Bellews had traditionally aligned themselves, in county politics at least, with the Jocelyns rather than the Fosters. However, by 1820, the decidedly anti-Catholic politics of the third Earl of Roden in the years before his father's death meant that Sir Edward Bellew had ceased to support that member of the family. Returning to the immediate neighbourhood, Lady Bellew, the Countess de Salis, and Lady Elizabeth McClintock were all very involved in improvements in the local area, including the establishment of several schools for local children and factories intended to train local people with marketable skills. This slide shows a leaflet promoting a plan to form an association at Dunlear for improving the condition of the peasantry of the adjoining district. The four lady patronesses were the Countess, Lady Elizabeth, Lady Bellew, and Mrs. Leslie Foster, the wife of John Leslie Foster of Rothesker, another Foster and a brother of the Countess. The focus of the various schemes was on providing the poor with the means and skills to enable themselves to help themselves. To enable them to help themselves. The Dunlear Association was intended to provide loans which would enable people to buy raw materials in order to manufacture items such as clothing and farming implements, which could then be sold for profit. Lady Bellew was also involved in schemes to provide work for young people and to train them in useful skills, and she was always anxious to encourage the tenant families to participate. Religion does not appear to have been an issue with the factories and development schemes, but it could sometimes be an issue in other charitable endeavours. But when religion did become an issue, the Bellews at least didn't have to look far for advice. Another close friend and frequent guest at Barmeath was Patrick Curtis, who had been appointed Catholic Archbishop of Armagh in 1819 and lived in Drogheda. Early in his tenure, Curtis intervened at Sir Edward Bellew's request in a local case of Protestant proselytism. This was the period of the Protestant Second Reformation, and Lady Elizabeth McClintock at Drumcar was a sister of one of the movement's leading proponents, the Church of Ireland Archbishop of Tuam, Power de Poor Trench. Lady Elizabeth and her husband were very active supporters and evidently embarked on the distribution of their Bibles to Catholic children in a school they had set up. But in a letter to his son Richard in 1820, after Dr. Curtis intervened, Sir Edward was happy to report that Dr. Curtis had convinced McClintock to admit that he was in error about the dissemination of the Bible by compulsion. Lady Bellew's letters provide more detail about the continued progress of the Second Reformation in Louth, particularly in relation to the McClintocks and the family of the Earl of Roden, the Jocelyns, who were also very much involved. One example, Lady Bellew wrote to Fanny a few weeks after Curtis's intervention with McClintock and said, "Our primate and Mr. McClintock are on amicable terms. The latter has in consequence retracted his order for sending away those who did not attend her school, which is now nearly broken up. McClintock has gone so far as to say he would give something towards the school that you subscribe to, but they continue indefatigable in their religious exertions. The Jocelyns seem to have joined with them, and if they did not carry some points too far, live a very praiseworthy Christian life. Poor Miss McCann says she is frightened for herself, they are all so good." But later that year, Lady Bellew reported to Fanny that she feared Miss McCann was going over fast to our new light. She now talks quite in another strain of the Drumcar people, who are worse than ever. They have applied, or rather Lady Elizabeth, to four of the parsons to request they would let the preacher they have got down to preach in their churches, but was refused by all of them. Mary Ann's letters also provided information about affairs in the local schools. The Countess de Salas was responsible for the establishment of one of these schools in the area. In this, she attempted to follow the secular model, which had been encouraged by the Kildare Place Society over the previous decade. She was evidently anxious not to cause problems. And after a dinner at Barmeath, at which both the Countess and the Archbishop were guests, Lady Bellew was able to inform Fanny that Dr. Curtis explained our doctrine on the reading of the Bible, as she wished to ascertain what she was to observe in her school, where she has a Catholic schoolmaster for the boys and a Protestant woman for the girls, but neither are allowed to interfere about religion. That she undertakes on Sundays, and ours go to Father Healy, as she terms him. Dr. Curtis told her that he had no objection to our own Bible being read in the school, provided there was no explanation attempted. This she has promised solemnly to adhere to and has got a large school. I went with her the other morning to see it. I proposed it myself. By admitting the Bible to be read, government on application give great assistance. Your father means to introduce it in his own three schools and to apply for public aid. A few weeks later, she also told Fanny that Dr. Curtis has not the smallest objection to reading the Bible where the teacher is Catholic, and complying with this, we should be able perhaps to get £50 from Kildare Street. The New Light, as we term them, are doing a vast deal of good, if it was nothing but stirring up others to exertion, particularly our clergymen. The Countess also co-opted Mary Ann's son, Patrick Bellew, to teach the Catholic children in her Sunday school. In describing this arrangement to Fanny, Lady Bellew noted the school was quite full, and also that the priest walks about the whole time, which I think annoys the McClintocks, but they have no power to object to what the Countess directs. So in addition to local news and events, Lady Bellew regularly updated Fanny with family news. One such occasion illustrates the impact of the earlier penal laws, which were still being felt by the family. In May 1823, Lady Bellew wrote to Fanny to inform her that they had just learned that Matthew Bellew, Sir Edward's brother, had died. "Poor Baron Matt, as we called him, your uncle, is dead. It took place so long back as last September. Your father has had great apprehension that it was the case from not having heard from him at the usual time of drawing on him for the little the poor fellow had left in this country, which should have been last Christmas. We were in hopes of seeing him once more. Your father is very sorry for him. What cruel laws have made our children exiles." Matt was next in age to Sir Edward and had also been educated in Douay. On finishing school in 1778, he had opted for a military career. But of course, as a Catholic, the British Army was barred to him. He joined the Austrian service as a cadet in 1779 and gained a commission a few years later. Another two brothers, Pat and John, also joined the Austrian service. Both were killed in battle without ever returning home. Matt did return to Ireland twice to see his family, once in 1785 and again in 1802. He retired from military service while posted in Cheshire, located on what is now the border of Poland and the Czech Republic. He remained in that city for the rest of his life. He died in Cheshire in September 1822, then in his early 60s. Matt's family never actually forgot him, and their financial obligations to him were honoured. But a few surviving letters from him at Barmeath show that by the time he died, he had largely lost contact with the family. Time and distance and the difficulties of communication due to the frequent state of warfare in Europe at the time can all be blamed. But so too can the penal laws, which barred the sons of Catholic families from military service at home and forced so many of them to join the French, Spanish, and later Austrian services. And that drawing on that slide is actually the uniform of the regiment that Matt was a member of, which is interesting choice of colors with the Austrian army. The white must have made for wonderful laundry bills. Lady Bellew's letters concerning family were naturally far more likely to discuss those closer to home, in particular Sir Edward's first cousins, the Donnellans of Ballydonnellan in County Galway and the Countess of Fingal. Malachy, Matthew and Francis Donnellan were orphaned at a young age and had been partly brought up with their Bellew cousins. Sir Patrick Bellew had played some guardianship role, albeit in an unofficial capacity, since as a Catholic he was at the time legally barred from guardianship. When Edward Bellew married Mary Ann Strange in 1786, his sister Frances married their cousin Malachy Donnellan at the same time. And a year earlier, Malachy's sister, another Frances, had married the future 8th Earl of Fingal. The letters to Fanny regularly included information about the Ballydonnellan family, who were generally referred to as the poor Donnellans. Malachy Donnellan, by 1820, was bankrupt. He was obliged on occasion to leave the country to avoid his creditors. His eldest son, John, spent some time in debtor's prison. His wife and children, younger children, were living with her brother, William Bellew, in Dublin. Matthew Donnellan and his wife and daughters were forced to move to France, where they could live more cheaply. Malachy and Frances Donnellan's eldest daughter had married well before financial disaster hit the family, but the Bellews and the Fingals spent years trying to help extricate the family from debt and trying to assist in finding careers for their nephews and husbands for their nieces. Neither the Bellews nor the Fingals were able to provide much in the way of direct financial aid. The finances of both families were typical of most landed families. Yearly rental income was invariably committed in advance to various payments for mortgages, trusts, and annuities, and there was little cash left over. But the connection between the Bellews and the Fingals was not just one of family. Sir Edward and Lady Bellew considered the Earl and Countess of Fingal as being amongst their closest friends. The Bellews were frequent visitors at Killeen and the Fingals at Barmeath. And of course, their shared interests naturally included not just family, but also Catholic politics and the campaign for emancipation. Lord Fingal's name is regularly found in the historiography of the emancipation campaign. Sir Edward Bellew's name only occasionally appears, but we can be quite sure that where Fingal was involved, then Sir Edward was either close by or at least very well informed. Despite having regained the franchise in 1793, Catholics in 1820 were still barred from serving as MPs or in the House of Lords, and the most senior government, judicial, and military roles likewise remained barred. Irish Catholics had been led to expect that full emancipation would quickly follow the union of Great Britain and Ireland in 1801. But by 1805, it was clear that any hope of this was dead, and a group of primarily middle-class Catholics in Dublin began once again to agitate for emancipation. Aware that any hope of success required at least an appearance of unanimity within the Catholic body, they were eager to secure the involvement of the Catholic aristocracy and gentry. Unanimity could not be assured. The earlier Catholic committee had split in 1791 over disagreements in methods of seeking relief. The split was roughly along class lines, with most of the gentry and aristocracy favoring conservative and polite methods, while the increasingly politically active middle classes, inspired by the French Revolution, began to push for a more forceful approach, which greatly alarmed the gentry. That split had damaged the campaign, and everyone was eager to avoid a recurrence. Lord Fingal, as the most senior of the 8 remaining Irish Catholic peers, was considered by the government, at least, as the natural leader of the Irish Catholics. And with an English mother, English estates, and an English education, albeit in exiled Catholic schools, he had the contacts and qualifications necessary for moving in government circles. In 1805, he was well aware that government were in no position to concede anything and was therefore reluctant to participate in the new campaign. But he was equally aware of the need to appear united. So he and Sir Edward Bellew eventually agreed. Fingal and Sir Edward were two of a delegation of five which took a petition to Parliament the following year. But as they at least had expected, the petition had little effect. Catholic unanimity didn't last long. Between 1808 and 1821, the question of the veto, of allowing the Crown a veto in the appointment of Catholic bishops in Ireland and Britain, split the body again. Those in favour of allowing some form of veto were largely, although not exclusively, of the gentry classes. Those against largely comprised the growing body of middle-class Catholics. A veto should not have been contentious. Similar arrangements already existed across Europe. But the issue was quickly seized on by the up-and-coming Daniel O'Connell, who actively promoted the idea that any form of veto in church affairs constituted an attack on the last untouched institution remaining to Irish Catholics. Most studies of the campaign have, of course, focused on O'Connell's role and the success of his innovative populist approach, which leveraged issues such as the veto. In recent years, the role played by the church hierarchy in the campaign has also received attention. But the role of the gentry has been much less closely looked at. The letters at Barmeath, written by Mary Ann and others of the family, can therefore improve our understanding of yet another aspect of that campaign. As an example of those letters, the progress of the 1821 bill for Catholic relief was closely followed by Lady Bellew. Her earlier letters record the long series of almost annual petitions which routinely raised and then dashed hopes. In 1821, it seemed there might finally be progress when a motion in the House of Commons to consider an emancipation bill was unexpectedly passed by a small majority. The news was joyously received at Barmeath. Lady Bellew wrote, "We have, as you may suppose, received the glad tidings with joy. When we almost began to despair, as often happens, the prospect brightens. How we all long for the next reading." Her excitement in describing the newspaper report was very evident. "What was my surprise and delight when I saw its contents? I read it over and over to myself, thinking I did not read right. We can talk or think of nothing else. Your father is fixing what honours we should pay our friends. He says he will have high mass." The fact that oppositioning was lessening clearly had immediate benefits, as she wrote that even if the bill failed, it will make us feel pleasanter and lower the tone of our enemies. "We were asked last week to a private party at the castle," and it's Dublin Castle, "and since the good news has arrived, I suppose they are more affectionate, for Dick sends us word this morning that they have asked us also to dinner on Saturday. I am rather sorry we cannot go to either, as it is the Assizes week where your father goes tomorrow. But I think he must feel pleasanter than he ever did before there. Even the very respectful manner in which they spoke of our claims was to me most flattering. No sneering or jibing wit, as used to be the case." So a very small improvement, but they weren't quite there yet. Following the motion, a bill was immediately prepared for reading in the Commons. A veto and securities were still at issue, so the bill included a proposal that a government commission be appointed to ensure the loyalty of candidates nominated as bishops and to inspect official correspondence from Rome, which was also intended to ensure no threat to the state. The anti-vetoists were, of course, unhappy with this, but the Bellews saw no cause for concern. Lady Bellew wrote that Sir Edward says our most experienced clergy here think we can comply with the terms offered by our friends in the House with some small modifications, which will be of so little consequence to them that probably having done so much for us that they will yield. I am so charitable as to hope O'Connell may fall a victim to his unmeaning violence, and that the common people may have sense enough to see real religion cannot be his motive, for he is sending forth everything most likely to seduce the ignorant. The implications of any inspection of correspondence had also evidently been exaggerated to the public. As Mary Ann added, "A very decent man who keeps a shop said to his customer, fine doings or confessions now are to be perused by government if they please. All this kind of folly is propagating here to keep up the flame. A few days later, Lady Bellew wrote again, this time taking great delight in seeing those who opposed the securities measures being put down. You see, our business is going on swimmingly. I think Lord Castlereagh is sincerely for us. How he gives it to Father Milner, Father Hayes, as he calls him, and O'Connell, who he says never exerted his talents for the good or happiness of his country. How I did enjoy this. Milner, of course, was John Milner, English bishop, who by that date was a strict anti-vetoist. The bill did pass the Commons, but eventually failed in the Lords. Once again, Lady Bellew's hopes were dashed. She wrote, I have not got over the loss of our question and am out of patience at the old story, you will get it next session. William Bellew, who is almost getting scrupulous in point of religion, says that he would not feel the least scruple in agreeing to all that is proposed in these bills. He says the clergy are contending about points that are not proposed at all by the bill and seem determined to misunderstand it. And as I said, Mary Ann closely followed all the politics throughout the period and heard numerous letters of this type. But slow progress with the emancipation campaign was only one of two major sources of frustration for Mary Ann in the 1820s. The second was the question of marriage for her eldest son. Patrick had finished his education in England in 1819, age 21, and was immediately launched into the Dublin season by his parents. The goal, of course, was to find a suitable wife for the eldest son and heir. It didn't go well. Patrick's first romance was with his first cousin Anne, one of the younger daughters of Malachy Donnellan. Lady Bellew provided details in a letter to Fanny in 1820. As with the previous generation, the Bellew and Donnellan cousins were very close. Their respective parents assumed that the pair's relationship was fraternal and only discovered the truth when gossip became public. Lengthy discussions involving Patrick, his parents, and Anne's aunt, Lady Fingal, eventually convinced him to end the relationship. Sir Edward agreed to take the blame, and a heartbroken Patrick told Anne that his parents had an insurmountable objection due to nearness of the blood. This was certainly plausible. Patrick and Anne were first cousins, her parents were first cousins, and there'd been a close relationship in the previous Donnellan generation. But it wasn't the real problem. The ongoing financial woes affecting the Donnellans meant that Anne had no dowry and little expectation of one. Lady Bellew, in writing to Fanny about Patrick's continuing dejection months later, wrote, "If she was provided for, it would be a great happiness to us." Patrick eventually recovered, mostly, although it cropped up again a few times. But over the following years, more candidates came and went. They were invariably either unsuitable or unavailable. In June 1822, Lady Bellew informed Fanny, "We need look no further to Lady E from some information I had. Lady C thinks her too young. She's also displeased with Sherry," this was their nickname for Pat, "and us. I suppose about the daily affair, since she is fond of her sister and resents what they consider a slight on Pat's part. I think they were very wrong if they were so serious about it. With their knowledge of the world, they must have discovered what a novice he was, just arrived from Mr. Collins," that was his school. "All lookout in that quarter is over." Lady E was Lady Emily de Burgh, daughter of the Countess of Clanrickard, who was evidently annoyed over an apparent slight to her niece by Pat when he had returned home to Ireland. But the Countess's sister's family, the Dalys of Rayford in Galway, still hoped for a match despite the earlier slight. In April 1823, Lady Bellew wrote of another side proposal for Miss Daly, "but I gave a decided negative. She's not right for him, even though she has what is here called a large fortune." So on the plus side, at least fortune wasn't her only requirement. The following month, Lady Bellew had to untangle Pat from a Fanny Rowan in Dublin. Pat had evidently led her on and raised the hopes of the young lady's parents, but the Rowans were not Catholic, so that was a non-starter. In December 1823, there were hopes of Miss Byrne in Louth, lately returned from France with her brother Edward Henry Byrne, who had inherited their mother's extensive property in Louth. But the presumably well-dowered Miss Byrne, although genteel, was not very good looking, and she and Pat did not get on in the least. Meanwhile, the Dalys back in Galway hadn't given up yet. Patrick had visited Galway in October that year, and the Donnellans later reported to Lady Bellew that the set made again by the Dalys was too evident. By sending the Miss Dalys on before him to Portumna the day after he dined at their own house, it is 18 or 20 miles, and no mamma with them, which is truly shocking behaviour for young ladies, obviously. Patrick's adventures in romance continued. But in March 1825, a serious contender finally appeared when a friend suggested a Miss Lawler from Tipperary. Her only surviving brother was ill and not expected to live, so the heiress qualification was met. And Lady Bellew told Fanny that Sir Edward's brother William had claimed that he should not consider there being a new family an objection if other circumstances answered, and the girl was in herself to be liked and had no objectionable connections. Further inquiries were made. Lady Bellew was pleased to learn that the girl was a good size and her hair darkish, so at all events it's not red. After establishing that the family had no connections to trade, it was decided an introduction should be made. But this was delayed by the death of the brother, although this did mean that Miss Lawler's portion of £10,000 now became £20,000. But when Pat finally met the young lady, Lady Bellew reported to Fanny that it hadn't gone well. Miss Lawler was too timid, although her figure, hair, and teeth were all good. But in this case, Patrick's own very candid letter to his sister probably best describes his feelings. He told Fanny that the 20,000 down with other chances besides staggers me, for I own I have a certain hankering after the filthy lucre, though more so as never having been hitherto overburdened with it. Perhaps I attach more happiness to the attainment of it than it will really bring. Be that as it may, of this I am certain, that were it not for the Dobbs, Miss Lawler would hardly live a quarter of an hour longer in my contemplation. Happily, Patrick decided against a marriage for purely financial reasons. But within the year, Patrick's younger brother Richard and Miss Lawler unexpectedly fell madly in love and eventually married, although sadly that marriage was short-lived as Mary Lawler died a year later. Pat's adventures continued for several more years, watched by his increasingly desperate mother, especially after Sir Edward's death in 1827, which meant that their eldest son was now Sir Patrick. In 1828, Lady Bellew hatched more plans and sent Pat in pursuit of Matilda Preston, the daughter of Lord Gormanston. The Prestons were in Rome at the time. We don't know whether that meeting actually happened, but Pat did finally find himself a wife while traveling. Anna Fermina de Mendoza, the very Catholic, very wealthy and very independent daughter of a Spanish naval officer and his English wife. They were married at her home in Bath in January 1829. And of course, the Catholic Emancipation Bill finally passed a few months later. Clearly, 1829 was a good year for Lady Bellew. In closing, one more letter written by Lady Bellew to Fanny after hearing the success of the early phases of the Emancipation Bill. What joyful news this morning. I offered up the mass in thanksgiving for our success. I think Wellington fought as hard as at Waterloo. It is certainly most gratifying to our vanity. God send we may show ourselves worthy of our good fortune. And that is the end. So thank you again to everyone for joining in. And in particular, thanks to Brew and Rosemary Bellew, who have so generously allowed us to work with this archive and have the opportunity to learn so much from it.